Hi, I'm Julianne Martin and I'm a Senior Process Engineer here at Lutra, and I'm with Luis Ortenzio, our Chief Engineer, and today we're going to talk about MABR and MBBR technology. So I guess we start with an explanation of what those are.
Yeah, so MABR stands for Membrane Aerated Biofilm Reactor, and MBBR stands for Moving Bed Biofilm Reactor. And yeah, obviously with biofilm in the name, they're biofilm processes. MBBR has millions of these little plastic media pieces, and bacteria grows on them, forming a biofilm. And this biofilm removes substrate like ammonium, butane, and nitrate, and it continuously sloughs off with new cells growing, which form new biofilm. The tank is usually aerated to both mix the influent and media, but also to provide oxygen for the bacteria. But you can also have anoxic systems, which are mixed with mechanical mixers. And MBBRs can be supplied as bolt-on packages, such as the one shown here, so they can be a quick and easy way to improve treatment, or they can be standalone treatment systems. MABR is a newer technology. MABR is essentially a oxygen aeration system where oxygen is passed through a membrane element. You grow biofilm on the outside of it, and the biofilm treats substrate similarly to MBBR. It's just this media is on a membrane rather than plastic media that's free floating in a tank. So those are those two processes.
Cool. And so what kind of applications would we find these suitable for, these two technologies?
In New Zealand, they're actually really applicable to oxidation pond effluent. And for a lot of municipalities where oxidation ponds are being stressed, or they're not able to meet new resource consent limits for nitrogen and phosphorus, you can bolt these on the back end of an oxidation pond and get nitrification and denitrification. And so at the point in time where a lot of work is being done in New Zealand on wastewater, there's a lot of application for these two processes right now.
Yeah. So what are we talking about in terms of effluent quality? What do you think you could achieve using these processes?
Yeah, so for MBBR, you typically need to have staged reactors. So you would have to have, you can have one reactor for nitrification, and then that can be followed by another reactor for denitrification where you dose carbon source. So you can dose acetic acid, or you can dose molasses, or any other suitable carbon source that's used. And you can get an ammonia less than one and a nitrate less than one. It's a technology that was invented in cold temperatures, so it's really resilient to cold temperatures as well. That's a question that a lot of people have with biofilm technologies, is how resilient is it to cold temperatures? And MBBR, yeah, works quite well with that. MABR is similar, but MABR, you don't necessarily need two tanks to do this work. You can grow nitrifiers on the membrane outside, and oxygen is going through the membranes and getting to that inner biofilm layer because it's counter diffusion.
Yeah.
And then you can dose carbon source if there is no carbon in the wastewater at that point, which there typically is in an oxidation pond effluent. You can grow denitrifying bacteria on the outer layer. So you can do all of that in one reactor, and you should be able to achieve similar effluent quality where you can essentially nitrify down to less than one and remove all the nitrate that you're producing by just dosing more acetic acid. So both processes can treat down to very low substrate levels for nitrogen.
Yeah. So there's not many of these processes in New Zealand already, but there's lots of MBBR. You've worked on quite a few MBBR plants.
Yeah, there are like thousands of MBBRs in the world. There are some in New Zealand, there are some in the Wellington area, but for a different application. It's just not a technology that has made its way to New Zealand. Yeah, I think it will be used across a lot of New Zealand soon because of the nutrient restrictions on discharge for ponds. But it also has a place in just non-pond plants.
Yeah.
Industrially, it can be used quite well with DAF. And MABR is just a relatively new technology in general, so it will be used a lot throughout the world. In New Zealand, it'll be used in New Zealand quite often as well.
And that's quite a good technology if you're thinking sustainability, because it can reduce power consumption.
Oh yeah, it's like it's you'll hear the term game changer for MABR, but it's not really the wrong word to use, because the use of the membrane element with oxygen going through it increases the oxygen transfer efficiency significantly. So the amount of power that's required for the treatment of this wastewater is a fraction of what you would need for like an activated sludge plant. You know, it's hard, like a pond is a pond, right? You're never gonna really need to put much energy into a pond.
Yeah.
But you know, you can only get so much treatment from a pond.
Yeah.
But you know, if you compare it to an activated sludge plant or something like that, yeah, the amount of power consumption savings you get with MABR is staggering. So from a perspective of another type of treatment technology that's come out recently, it's hard to compare it to anything else because, yeah, it just has so much potential. And we're really just learning the amount. I think worldwide, most people are just learning how much potential MABR really has.
Well, so for the operators, if any operators are listening, how easy are these plants to operate? Are they fickle or are they pretty good?
Well, from an operations perspective, I can speak directly about MBBR because I've operated MBBRs. MBBRs tend to be pretty simple plants to operate. And so screening is something that's of importance. So you should really have 3mm screening, which is pretty commonplace now. So it's not really that concerning from an operations perspective. But it's a pass-through system, so really you just have to make sure that if it's an aerobic reactor, that it's aerating the way it's supposed to and there's enough DO, but generally that's a pretty easy process to monitor.
Yeah.
And then aside from just sampling, when you have to sample, some process control sampling, the biofilm is pretty self-regulating on the media because it mixes and it shears itself.
Yeah.
So it's self-regulating. So there really isn't much from an operations perspective that you need to do for MBBR.
Yeah. I suppose it would be a bit more resistant to toxic or shock loads maybe?
Yeah, than like a conventional activated sludge plant, because the HRT is so short that like a toxic discharge or even a shock load generally will hit the MBBR and then pass through relatively quickly. It doesn't get recycled and it doesn't sit in a large reactor like it would in an activated sludge plant.
Yeah.
For operation of an MABR, I think screening is more critical in an MABR, so they generally want 2mm screening. I think people are getting quite used to screening to an MBR level, so I think that's a pretty low risk thing. There's really not much concern from a supplier perspective. And so I guess a lot of my experience, I guess, or my understanding is coming from suppliers, is that there isn't much of a concern around fouling because it's air going through it rather than water and potentially chemical fouling and solids fouling. Generally, you might have, rather than a DO reading in the tank, you have off-gas oxygen concentration. So the air that you're putting into the membrane, some of that oxygen gets consumed by the biofilm and the treatment. And then what's going out, you measure the oxygen concentration. So you can see a lot about what's going on through just looking at the oxygen off-gas concentration. The off-gas oxygen concentration, I should say. So most of it's just monitoring.
Yeah.
And monitoring the effluent quality through sampling. So from a perspective of biofilm control, that's all done through automatic control systems and timers and things like that. So from an operations perspective, I think MABR is quite easy to operate. But again, I don't have direct experience on that. But I think we're still learning a lot with regards to the number of installations that exist throughout the world. So I think we'll learn a lot more in the next 2 to 5 years on what it takes to operate an MABR system.
suppose there's replacement of the membranes at some stage.
That's interesting because it's not like a filtration membrane.
Yeah.
Suppliers are saying that you don't actually need to renew them. So that's a big thing that actually comes up in engineering evaluations when you look at NPVs, because people, we still want to be a little conservative and consider a renewal frequency.
Yeah.
Because we don't know. Like, I don't think any of the MABRs have been around for longer than 10 years at a large scale.
Yeah.
So I think we still have a lot of return on experience to gain from that in the next couple of years. But right now, suppliers claim like it's just acting as a biofilm media.
Yeah.
And then the oxygen transfer from the inside out doesn't actually create any kind of wear or tear or fouling. Obviously, if you get stuff coming through because your screening's poor, it's going to tear that up, but that's really a different issue.
Yeah, true. Well, thanks for that, Lois. That was really interesting.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously it was a pretty broad topic and we covered it in a really short period of time, so we're just scratching the surface. If you want to learn more, reach out to us here at Lutra and we'll answer your questions, and make sure you watch out for the next video.